The X-Men started in 1963. Stan Lee and Jack Kirby, the guys who created pretty much everything except Spider-Man back then, came up with their new group. Originally, it was going to be called The Mutants, I think, until Martin Goodman, the publisher, said, "What the hell are mutants?" So they came up with the name The X-Men instead. The original team was Angel, Iceman, a very different Beast, Marvel Girl, and Cyclops, with Professor X running the team. Stan and Jack left the book after about a year and a half. It was replaced by a number of solid but mid-level artists and writers. Steranko did a few issues briefly and kind of highlit the book. And then Roy Thomas and Neil Adams took over for a great run. I mean, a wonderfully written and wonderfully drawn run. But the book never seemed to be a hit, ever, its entire run. And after about 65, 70 issues, it became a reprint book. They just started reprinting the original stuff. And it was fallow. I mean, the book ran about 20-odd issues as a reprint. Was trying different packages. It wasn't simply giant-sized X-Men number one. There was giant-sized Chillers, giant-sized Werewolf, the single most uncomfortable comic book title in history, giant-sized Man-Thing. They tried a lot of different titles in that particular format, and X-Men was one of them. The book was going to be bi-monthly initially, and double-sized stories, and we wanted to see how it would sell. And before we got to the second issue, they decided to cancel the giant-sized format. And so what was going to be Giant Size X-Men 2 became X-Men 94 and 95.
I had gone over to Marvel and was looking around for work, and they'd given me some odd jobs, and I'd inked some issues of the Avengers and penciled a couple of Giant Size issues, but I wanted something that I could stay on regularly. Roy Thomas was editor-in-chief at the time, and Roy wanted to start it all over again, possibly with new characters. I'd been badgering him for something to do, and he says, "All right, you come in on it as the artist."
Roy Thomas, who was the editor-in-chief of the comics company at that point, kept talking about the possibility of finding a way to revive the X-Men as an international group of heroes. They had a lot of different countries publishing their books, and they thought, well, maybe if we did a book where characters from countries where the books are very successful appeared, we can sell even more copies.
Len Wein was the choice as writer, and doing a plotting session, the two of us would kick ideas around, and there was actually some other guys from the Marvel bullpen that sat in on it too, including Chris Claremont, who wound up writing the book later on.
We wanted to put together a new team. You had to do an international team. And Dave had this amazing book of character designs he had done over the years. And we sat down together one day and said, "All right, what would make a great team?"
Nightcrawler was a character I came up with when I was still in the Navy. And I had an idea for a possible book called The Intruder. Nightcrawler was a demon at the time. And he had screwed up on a mission from hell, and rather than go back and face punishment, he stayed up on the mortal plane, and he was a sidekick to the Intruder. Then, when I was doing the Legion of Superheroes, I proposed Nightcrawler as a Legionnaire, and editor Murray Boltonoff thought he was too funny looking and shot that down, so he wound up being an X-Man. He evolved a little bit along the way, and I dropped the demon aspect of Nightcrawler, but basically it was the same character all along.
Storm was actually a combination of two other characters. They originally had a character called the Black Cat and a character called Tempest, and neither of those characters were gelling. And I think Roy Thomas suggested one day, he said, "Well, why just make one character out of it? Take his powers and her look and personality and put them together." And we kind of went, "Duh," and did. And that's how we got Storm.
One caution that Len Wein had was when I gave her the white hair, he was afraid that readers were going to think she was somebody's grandmother. And I said, "Trust me, nobody's going to think she's a grandmother." You know? Colossus was roughly based on a character that I'd come up with in college that I called Mr. Steel. We had decided that we wanted a Russian character, and so I made this guy a big, burly Russian farm boy, and he transformed into the organic steel, as they called it, and he was bulletproof, and he was, you know, relatively free of physical harm. I mean, he actually jumped out of an airplane one time, and then Storm caught him on the way down. She says, "Are you nuts? What are you doing?" And he says, "I'm not going to be hurt. You know, what is it? You know, leave me alone." He was a fun character. He was supposed to have been the lead character in the book, and we didn't use him that way. I mean, he was always, we put him up front on the covers because he was a great visual, but he wound up getting less development than any of the other characters we had until much later in the series.
We created Thunderbird with the specific purpose of killing him in the end of the second story. It had never been done before. And our theory was, if we can kill off somebody that hopefully characters will have come to like, they'll never know what's coming next in the book. And there's nothing better than keeping your audience off balance. We figured, kill somebody now, and from that point on, every time we threatened a character, they would never know if they would make it or not.
Up to that point, any character with an Indian background had always been put in buckskin, and I was so tired of Indian characters in buckskin, you know, and so I wanted, you know, give him a legitimate superhero costume like the others. And I actually liked him quite a lot and really regretted that we wound up killing him off, but the reason that the actual reason we killed him off was because he was an obnoxious loudmouth, and Wolverine did that better.
Wolverine's one of those bizarre cases. I was doing a book for Marvel called Brother Voodoo, and it was set basically in Haiti and in Jamaica. So I was doing Jamaican and Haitian accents for a lot of the characters. And Roy called me in one day and said, "You know, you're doing something I cannot do as a writer. I cannot write accents to save my life. Why don't you come up with a Canadian character? Because I'd love to see how you'd write a Canadian accent." And I said, "Fine." He said, "You know, Wolverine's a great name." And I said, "Perfect." And I took the name and I did research. Wolverines are short, feisty, really nasty characters with razor-sharp claws that will attack things 10 times their size without hesitation. Don't come near them, don't bother them, they'll kill you. I went, there's a character to find right there. So I took those elements and put them together for the basic personality traits initially of Wolverine. My theory initially was that the claws were in his gloves. The blue cloth was covering essentially adamantium gloves. Adamantium being indestructible, you could put claws in the backs of the glove and not have them rip off every time he used them if the whole glove was made out of metal. And they telescoped. They were, again, a molecule thick in each section, but it's indestructible metal, so it makes no difference how thick it is. And they would collapse back into these compartments in the back of the glove. And it was as much a surprise to me as anybody later on when it turned out, they're part of his body. Who knew?